But I'm reading today from Acts chapter number 8 and verse number 30 from a very familiar passage. And Philip ran thither to meet him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah and said, Understandest thou what thou readest? And he said, How can I, except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he should come up and sit with him. The place of the scripture which he read was this, He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shearer, so he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation his judgment was taken away. Who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speaketh the prophet this, of himself or of some other man? Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. Amen. Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. Amen. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your word. It's forever settled in heaven. I pray, O God, that as your anointing rests upon your word, so it would rest upon me here today. In the name of the Lord, we ask these things. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you for standing in honor to the Word of God. Inquisitive mind that comes through reading the Word of God. It's always fun to read the Word of God as a literal Word of God and try to plug it in, try to apply it to today. This story is real interesting in the fact that actually there's a couple things even before the reading that we read. The Ethiopian eunuch had been traveling back from Jerusalem. My personal opinion was that he had just purchased the book of Isaiah, and he was reading that book. Books at that time were extremely rare to come by. But he had been to Jerusalem to worship God. When he got there, there was still a hunger in his heart for more of God. And so he purchased the only book that he could buy, and that was the book of Isaiah. First thing that I have to say to us today is it is a privilege to have the whole Word of God. I am thankful. Now, if I only had the book of Isaiah, that's a powerful book. But I am thankful for the privilege that I've got Genesis all the way to Revelations. I'm thankful that I can open up a book, a chapter in Psalms whenever I'm feeling a little bit down, and it can lift me up. Amen. But this man was trying his best to seek out the things of God on his own just from the book of Isaiah. Just all alone. And God was so concerned about one man that he used an evangelist God had just been blessing this evangelist by the name of Philip, blessing him in a revival in Samaria. There were a lot of people being baptized in Jesus' name. A lot of people being healed. And Peter and John had just come to Samaria. And they were praying for people. And folks were receiving the Holy Ghost, you know, all over the place. And Philip was rejoicing in the revival because he not only was the evangelist for the moment, but he was the evangelist that started the church. He came into the town when there was nobody, amen, that believed in Jesus, and he started preaching Jesus. That was the only thing he knew how to preach. And he preached Jesus, and folks were getting baptized and getting healed, and now Peter and John are laying their hands on folks, and they're receiving the Holy Ghost. And it's quite the revival. And it would seem to me like Philip would have said, you know, I think that God has a work for me here in Samaria. There's no way that I'm going to be moved from this plan, from this place. But the Bible gives us indication that the Spirit of the Lord took him from Samaria and placed him in the wilderness. Now, my imagination is running a little bit wild. I just ask the question, did something similar to what happened to Elijah happen to Philip? Did a whirlwind come by and pick him up and carry him? But I'm not sure, because they didn't have airplanes. But somehow God got a hold of this man and picked him up from a city and carried him out into middle of the desert. And he set him in the middle of the desert, and the only individual that he saw was a chariot and some horses pulling that chariot with an Ethiopian eunuch and at least one servant. Now, I don't know who all else was there, but it just wasn't that many folks there. And God took him away from this mass revival to reach, to touch one individual. I just want us to know today that he still is in that business.
Right.
That whenever we think that we aren't anything in the kingdom of God, remember that God, amen, is so concerned about, excuse me, but he's so concerned about me that he would get me from one place and put me in a different place, or he'll put somebody within my life at the time when I need it the most, and me not knowing a thing, and all of a sudden God will use that opportunity to minister to the need that I have within my life. Oh, hallelujah. My wife was right after her mother passed away. The day that her mother passed, or the day of the funeral, they sang the song at the funeral, "Jesus, Hold My Hand," and on that next Sunday, my wife's brother and his wife, brother and sister Griffin, down in Texas, they were in service on that Sunday, and they had a guest speaker, and brother. And my brother-in-law had asked, as a matter of fact, Brother Calk came here and preached. It was an evangelist, preached several years ago, many years ago when my dad was still pastoring. But Brother Calk came through and preached on that Sunday there, and as he was in the middle of his preaching, at the beginning of his preaching, right before he started preaching, he said, "You know," he said, "I just feel like the Lord, as I was driving over here, the Lord spoke to me and said that I need to have my wife sing a song." And he looked at his wife and said, "Could you sing 'Jesus, Hold My Hand'?" And they said of all the songs that he could pick out of the songbook, the song that had been used at that funeral was used as a ministry to them on that day. Well, my wife, when she heard the story, she said, "That's great and everything. I didn't know this," but she began to pray and saying, "Lord, you know, if you'll speak to them and touch them that way, why can't you do something like that for me?" And so here we are on a Christmas service here at Apostolic Bible Church, and Brother Islip and his son comes in. And actually, the whole family was there, but his son and Brother Islip come up. And, of course, anytime Brother Islip comes, we always have him play his horn. And he said, "Okay." And I asked him, and he said, "Sure, here's a Christmas song." He played a Christmas song. And I said, "Play another one." And he said, "Okay." And he played another one. And I said, "Oh, man, come on. We could do better than that. Get another one." And he said, "Okay." He said, "Well, it's not a Christmas one, but I just feel like, could you give me the key of, I feel like playing 'Jesus, Hold My Hand.'" Now, it might not have meant anything else to anybody else, but God reached down in that service and said, "I'm concerned about Amy Bollinger. I'm concerned enough about her that I'm going to take some folks from the UP of all places. And I'm going to bring them to church on a Sunday night on a Christmas service. And it's going to seem like it's not the service to play, amen, Jesus hold my hand. But it is the service to play Jesus hold my hand, because there's somebody that's asked for a special request. They've asked me, amen, to touch them and to use a particular song. Can I tell you that if God would do that for my wife, God wants to do that for each one of us. And God is concerned about our lives, amen, in every aspect of our life. And when it seems like, amen, nothing is going right, amen, we can look and say, God, I need your help one more time. And God, amen, it's amazing the way that God works. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. And I say that, I don't want to say unbelievable, because it is believable. Amen. But I watch as God, amen, begins to work in our lives. Amen. Whether it's a financial miracle that we need, whether it's a spiritual answer that we need, somehow along the way, God just kind of says, I see someone that has a need today, and I need you to stop by at this particular moment. I don't know that Philip knew, amen, what the eunuch was going through. I don't know, amen, that he even understood that he was going to minister to an Ethiopian eunuch. The only thing that I know is that he followed the plan of God, and God used him, amen, to bring salvation to a man that was hungry, amen, a man that was going back to the nation of Ethiopia. And the only thing that he had, amen, was the book of Isaiah. But oh my, what a book that he had, a book that would tell of salvation, a book that would tell of the Redeemer, a book that would tell, hallelujah, of the Savior, a book that would tell, amen, of Calvary, and from that book, amen, of all the scriptures that he could be reading was the scripture, amen, about Jesus Christ. And you know, some say, well, that's a coincidence. No, I say that God was in it. And God had him open the book to that particular, of all the pages, that of all the places in that scroll that he could have been at, for him to be at that particular chapter, at that particular time. You know, somehow I believe that God just kind of, Philip, you got to hurry and get there. Run, because he's getting ready to get to the next chapter. It might be more confusing to him. I know you can still preach Jesus, but this is the chapter I need to be him to be on when you get there. Hurry, run a little faster. You know, because I need you here right at this particular time. And God has a way of reaching into our lives, amen, at the right time, at the right place, amen. And when he does, amen, it's all about his care for us. Man, if I can just get a hold of this to understand how much he cares for me. As a matter of fact, if I can understand that God cared enough for me, and cared enough for us, but this morning, the Lord just said, why don't you preach Jesus for a minute or two? And I said, Lord, I don't know what I'm going to preach that second service. I know you've given me the message for the first service, but I need something for the second service. And I'm not grabbing at straws when I say this. But I feel like the Holy Ghost spoke to me. He said, start preaching Jesus. Because no matter what we face in our lives, Jesus is there for us. And though I can't be with you at your particular moment, and I can't, you know, I can't be in Owosso and Lansing at the same time. I can't be where Brother Robertson lives and where Sister Vess lives at the same time. I can't be, but but the Jesus that I serve. Man, what a God that would look down where Sister Doris lives all by herself, amen, and say in the southern part of Lansing, and say, I know exactly where she lives, and I'm concerned about her, and I love her. Hallelujah. Amen. And old Sister Caven, she's over there on the other side on Willow, and God's just looking down the way, and he's saying, yes, Sister Caven thinks that she might be the only Christian in that house, but you know what? If she's the only one, I'm concerned about her, and I love her. And God looks at each one of us, and I know that at times, this might sound simple to somebody here today, but to somebody else, I feel like the Lord is speaking to tell you that where you're at right now, and where you're at right now, God sent me to tell you you're not alone, and that He cares for you, and that He wants to minister to you. And Jesus is in this place. And as we begin to worship today, I felt the presence of Jesus walk into the room. And He's here. I got a boatload of scriptures, but this is not the way. The Lord just kind of pushed me to this type of deal, and I got to dwell here instead. I'll probably preach what I got on the notes another day, but I just keep on. I can't get away from it. Jesus is so concerned about our lives that He would shut everything else down to say, I love you. And if you'll take this message that He loves you and He's concerned about you and apply it to your life, yeah, there's something powerful that the Lord has done today. He stopped a chariot, and He's put me on your chariot just for a minute, because there's things that you need, and He wants you to know that your answer is still found in Jesus. Everything that you need is found in Jesus Christ. I know that sometimes we say, I depend upon Him. Your answer is in Him. For in Him we live and move and breathe and we have our being. It's our hope of salvation. It's our hope for healing. It's our hope of eternal life. Everything that we have and we need is found in Jesus Christ. And old Philip said, the only message I ever had to preach was Jesus. I haven't got 20 or 30 or 50 messages that I've developed, and I haven't had time to study for this one, but I know what I'm supposed to be speaking right now. Jesus loves you enough, Mr. Ethiopian eunuch, to care for you enough to get me out of one revival and bring me to where you're at. Amen. Because He loves you. And by the time He was done with His little message about Jesus, amen, the Ethiopian eunuch was saying, hey, look, what a coincidence. There's water in the middle of the desert. Here's water. What doth hinder me from being baptized? And he got baptized in the precious name of Jesus Christ for the remission of his sins. And the Bible said he went on his way rejoicing. That tells me he got the Holy Ghost. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. And Philip went the other way. God took him somewhere else. I have no idea exactly all the places that God took him. But God brought him in for the moment that he needed him there. And God has brought us to this moment. Amen. Today. amen, for a meeting and an encounter with God. Hallelujah. And I'm done preaching. Because we're there. And if we could stand together and worship God, I just feel like that the Lord wants to embrace somebody and let them know, I really do care for you. As a church, let's worship the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. And I just feel like the Lord, you know that the Lord has spoken to your heart today. Hallelujah. And why don't you accept what the Lord has said? The Lord loves you. He cares for you. He stopped the whole service because he loves you today. Let's worship him.